Romans chapter 15. I'm going to ask that you would take your copy of God's Word and turn with me to Romans chapter 15. Look with me at the concluding verses there, verses 30 through 33. Praise of God, we will conclude 15th chapter of the book of Romans, which means that we have one more chapter to go. One more chapter of the book of Romans to go. God willing, I'm going to try to glean about four or five sermons from that 16th chapter. At least four or five. You'll see how it goes. Today we're looking at Romans chapter 15, verses 30 through 33. Trust that everyone has it. The word of our God reads like this. Now I urge you, brethren, by our Lord Jesus Christ, and by the love of the Spirit, to strive together with me in your prayers to God for me, that I may be rescued from those who are disobedient in Judea, and that my service for Jerusalem may prove acceptable to the saints. So that I may come to you in joy by the will of God and find refreshing rest in your company. Now, verse 31, may the God of peace be with you all. Amen. Now I urge you, brethren, by the Lord Jesus Christ and by the love of the Spirit, to strive together with me in your prayers to God for me, that I may be rescued from those who are disobedient in Judea, in that my service for Jerusalem may prove acceptable to the saints, so that I may come to you in joy by the will of God and find refreshing rest in your company. Now, the God of peace be with you. Amen. I want to preach this morning from the subject, praying for one another. You may have your seats. Thank you very much, ushers. You're certainly too kind. Praying for one another. Praying for one another. Once there was a mouse peeking through a crack in the wall. As this mouse was peeking through a crack in the wall, he noticed a farmer and his wife sitting on the couch about to open a package. Curious to know what was inside the package, the mouse became filled with anxiety. As he sat there, looking through the crack in the wall, watching this farmer and his wife ramble to open this package, he was filled with anxiety. But his anxiety was quickly turned into devastation. His anxiety, this mouse's anxiety, was quickly turned into devastation when he found out that contained inside of the package was a mouse trap. And this mouse saw this mouse trap. He rushed from that crack in the wall out into the farmyard, proclaiming
chickens who were in the farmyard who were busy nesting their eggs. And he proclaimed his message, there's a mouse trap in the house. A mouse trap in the house, and I need for you to pray for me. But because the chickens were busy nesting their eggs, they simply stated to the mouse that, Mr. Mouse, I can see that that mouse trap in that house is of great concern to you, but we will pray for you just as soon as we are done nesting our eggs. Satisfied with this, the mouse went on his way. But when the mouse left, the chickens did everything but pray for the mouse. But that didn't stop the mouse. The mouse made his way over to the pigs, who were bathing themselves in their slop, and he proclaimed the same message that he had proclaimed to the chickens. There is a mouse trap in the house. Mouse trap in the house. But because the pigs were busy bathing themselves in their slop, the pigs looked at the mouse and said, Mr. Mouse, can't you see that we are busy bathing ourselves in our slop? As soon as we are done, we will pray for you in that mouse trap. Satisfied with this, the mouse went on his way, only to find that the pigs never did what they said they were going to do. The mouse had one more stop to make. He had already visited the chickens. He had already visited the pigs. Now he made his way to the cows. And he proclaimed the same message to the cows that he proclaimed to the chickens and the pigs. He lifted up his voice and he said, there's a mouse trap in the house. Mouse trap in the house. But the cows were too busy grazing in the grass. And they lifted up their voice to the mouse and said, Mr. Mouse, can't you see that we are busy grazing in the grass? As soon as we are done grazing in the grass, we will do what you have asked us to do. The mouse was satisfied with this and went on his way. Nighttime had come now. The farmer and his wife had set the mouse trap. The chickens had put themselves to rest. The pigs had put themselves to rest. The cows had put themselves to rest, but the mouse could not sleep thinking about the mouse trap. Before day, the farmer and his wife heard a sound that they thought was indeed a mouse trap. Waking up out of her sleep, the farmer's wife, thinking that she had finally caught that mouse that she so desperately desired to get rid of, walked around in the dark, feeling her way through. Only the mouse trap had indeed caught something. It just wasn't the mouse. The mouse trap had caught a venomous snake. And the snake, aggravated at the fact that the mouse trap had caught him, out of aggravation, he bit the farmer's wife. The farmer took his wife to the hospital, where they treated her, made her comfortable, and sent her home with a fever. Husband, desperate to find some relief for his wife, he said, picked up the phone and called his mother and said, Mama, what can break a fever? Which the farmer's mother told him, a pot of chicken noodle soup will break the fever. So the farmer went out because he eventually passed away. And at the repast, not only was his family there, not only was her family there, but everybody who attended the funeral showed up at his house, and to make sure that he had enough food to feed everybody, he went outside and slaughtered the cows in order to feed everybody in the house. While everybody was over his house on his farm at the repast, the mouse, peeking through that same crack in the wall, seeing all of the chickens that had been slaughtered, seeing all of the pigs that had been slaughtered, seeing all of the cows that had been slaughtered, buried his head in the locks of his shoulders and said, "If you would have just prayed for me, none of this would have happened." Likewise, ladies and gentlemen, I have discovered that there are many ministers of the gospel of Christ who solicit the prayers of other believers only to find out that there is nobody, but nobody, who is willing to pray for them. In other words, ladies and gentlemen, I have grievously discovered that there are many ministers who devote their time to making house calls to pray for those who are sick and shut in. There are many ministers who devote their time to making hospital visits to pray for those who are laying on their beds of affliction. There are many ministers who devote their time to going to funerals to say a word of encouragement and to pray for the grieving family, only to find that when the minister needs prayer, when the minister is sick and shut in, when the minister is lying in the hospital on his bed of affliction, when the minister is grieving the loss of his loved one, there is nobody, but nobody, who is willing to pray for him. But I stood up to inform the Second Advent Baptist Church on this morning that if a minister can take time out of his schedule to pray for you, then you ought to be able to take time out of your schedule to pray for him. As for there's a natural question arises out of the text. Why should you pray for ministers who carry the gospel of Christ? Why should both you and I pray for ministers who carry the gospel of Christ? Here, in our selected text, Romans chapter 15, verses 30 through 33, Paul, under the unction of the Holy Spirit, makes known to us why it is that both you and I should pray for ministers who carry the gospel of Christ. First, you should pray for ministers who carry the gospel of Christ because, hear me, ministers need the prayers of believers. Ministers need the prayers of believers. If you graced us with your presence on last week, then you would have heard me preach a sermon entitled Meeting the Needs of One Another. It was inside that little sermon that the question was raised, why should both you and I meet the needs of those who carry the gospel of Christ? And if you took good notes, then you should have learned that both you and I should meet the needs of those who carry the gospel of Christ because ministers are commissioned to preach the gospel. But not only are ministers commissioned to preach the gospel, but you and I should take care of the needs of those who carry the gospel of Christ because believers are connected to other believers by the Spirit of God. Not only are believers connected to other believers by the Spirit of God, but both you and I should meet the needs of those who carry the gospel of Jesus Christ, because godly ministers minister the message of salvation. It was based on that argument that Paul transitions into Romans chapter 15, particularly verses 30, 31, and 32, by acknowledging his need for the believers to pray, hear me, with and for him. Paul transitions with the temporal connecting word now. Now, that is, as a result of the fact that you now know what Paul planned to do. You were here last week. You know that Paul was in Macedonia and Achaia. You remember that Paul had just got a gift from those believers in Macedonia and Achaia, and his plan was to take that gift that he had got from them to Jerusalem. And after Paul left Jerusalem, his plan then was to go down to Spain. But before he got to Spain, his plan was to stop in Rome. Paul says, now that you know what I intend to do, now that you know where I intend to go, here is what I need for you to do. I urge you. Paul says, brethren, by the Lord Jesus Christ. Paul urges believers. The word urge here comes from the compound Greek word parakaleo. Parakaleo. Kaleo is the Greek word where we get our English word call from. It simply means to ask. It means to summon, or it simply means to ask with the expectation that what you ask for will be complied with. This is interesting, ladies and gentlemen, because notice that Paul's use of the word urge here is not a command. Paul does not command believers to pray for him. Paul does not demand that believers pray for him. Paul urges believers to pray for him. To urge is somewhere in between a command and a simple ask. Paul is asking believers to pray for him. But he's asking them to pray for him with the expectation that they will. Paul says, I urge you, brethren, I urge you, believers, by the Lord Jesus Christ and by the love of the Spirit. When you understand what Paul is doing here, then you will understand why Paul does not find it necessary to command believers to pray for him. When you understand what Paul is doing here, you will understand why Paul does not demand that believers pray for him. Paul says, I'm asking you to pray for me. I'm not commanding you to pray for me. I'm not telling you you need to pray for me. I'm not telling you that you should pray for me. I'm asking you to pray for me. Notice the base of Paul's request. Paul, on what grounds should we meet your request? Paul says, I'm asking you to pray for me by the Lord Jesus Christ. The word Lord here comes from the Greek word kurios. It simply refers to a person who is under the authority of another person. Paul says, Lord Jesus Christ. In other words, Paul says, you are under the authority of Jesus Christ. You and I are both under the authority of Jesus Christ. This is why I'm asking asking you to pray for me. This is why I'm not telling you to pray for me. This is why I'm not commanding you to pray for me. I'm asking you to pray for me. Hear me. Because of who you are. You are servants of Christ, and you shouldn't have to beg a servant of Christ to pray for another servant of Christ. You shouldn't have to demand a servant of Christ to pray for another servant of Christ. Paul says, I ain't demanding you. I'm just going to ask you. Because of who you are. Praying for one another is what you should do. But there's another basis here. Paul says, I'm asking you to pray for me. Because of who you are. You are under the authority of Jesus Christ. You are servants of Jesus Christ. But I'm also asking you to pray for me by the love of the Spirit. Allow me to be technical here for just a moment. Love of the Spirit. The word Spirit here, pneuma in the Greek, is a noun. Noun refers to a person, place, or thing. Here, Spirit refers to a person. God the Father is a person. God the Son is a person. God the Spirit is a person. Spirit is a noun used in what is called the genitive case. A noun used in the genitive case does one of two things. A noun used in the genitive case can either describe something about a person, or a noun used in the genitive case can show what a person possesses. Here the argument is for the latter. Paul says, I'm asking you to pray for me by the love of the Spirit. The Spirit possesses love. The Spirit owns love. Hear me. The Spirit has love in the palm of its hands. And that same Spirit that has love in Him is in you. You ever hear the phrase, mi casa es su casa? That means my home is your home. That means whatever I have, you have. That means if there's food in there, you can eat it. That means if there's clothes in there, you can wear them. Paul says, I'm asking you to pray for me because you possess the Spirit. And the Spirit possesses love, which means you possess the same thing that the Spirit possesses. Paul, what do you mean by love? The Greek word that Paul uses here for love, you know it. It's agape. It's godly love. It's that kind of love that supplies what a person needs. It's that kind of love that God had when He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in Him shall not perish. Agape is love that meets the needs of those who cannot meet their own. Paul says, I'm asking you to pray for me because of who you are in Christ, and because if you got the Spirit of God, praying is just what you do. I'm asking you to pray for me. I'm urging you to pray for me. I'm not commanding that you pray for me, no. But I do expect you to pray for me. I'm not demanding that you spend an hour a day praying for me. But I'm saying that if you are a Christian, if you possess the love of the Spirit, praying for ministers is what you do. Paul says, I urge you, by the Lord Jesus Christ and by the love of the Spirit. This is interesting.
to strive together with me in your prayers. Briefly, let me say the "with me" there means that Paul was already praying for himself. Paul indirectly appears to communicate that I'm not going to ask you to do for me what I'm not already doing for myself. I'm praying, but I'm asking you to pray as well. Paul says, I'm urging you to strive together with me in your prayers. Or strive in, you may find this interesting, comes from the Greek word agonizo. It's where we get our English word agony from. To agonize over something means to put all of your effort into it. It means that it doesn't matter if you're sweating, it doesn't matter if your bones are hurting, it doesn't matter if your back is hurting, you're gonna keep doing it until you get the job done. Paul says, I need for you to strive. I need for you to pray without ceasing. I need for you to fervently pray. I need for you to get camel knees. They refer to a people with camel knees as to a person who's always praying. James in your Bible was referred to as camel knees because he was always praying. His knees looked like the knees of a camel because he was always on them. Paul says, I need for you to strive. I need for you to agonize in prayer. This bothers me. This tickles my membrane. Because Paul just got through saying that we are servants, we are under the authority of Jesus Christ, so praying is what we do. Paul just got through saying that we have the Spirit of God. The Spirit of God has the love of God. And it's inside of us, so praying is just what we ought to do. But then Paul says, I'm asking you to strive with me in prayer, getting for me. I'll say it again. See if you'll pick it up. Paul says, I'm asking you to agonize in prayer for me. No, still ain't got it. I'm asking you to pray without stopping for me. No. I'm asking you to pray fervently in prayer, not for you. I'm asking you to do it for me. Paul, why do you have to ask believers to not give up in prayer? Paul understood that the reason that I have to ask believers not to give up in prayer for me is because you don't have to ask a believer not to give up in prayer for them. But you do have to ask them not to give up in prayer for you. Let me tell you what I'm talking about. When your child acting like they ain't got no sin, you will pray all night long. When your job is on the line, you will pray all night long. When your body has sickness on the inside, you will pray all night long. When your family is falling apart, you will pray all night long. But what happens when I ask you to pray about my family? I gotta ask you, please don't stop praying. Please, please, please don't stop praying. What happens when I ask you to pray about my job? I gotta beg you, please don't stop praying. You don't have a problem. Paul understood that we don't have a problem praying for us. But we got a problem praying for others. It's hard to pray for someone else, isn't it? It's hard to pray without ceasing for someone else. But when it's your problem, you ain't got no problem. I just pray and pray and pray. And you mention someone else every once in a while. Paul Paul says, I'm asking you, don't give up in praying for me. Don't stop praying for me.
You know what I have to do. You know what I'm trying to do. You know what I have to go through. And I'm asking the saints, pray
for me. Strive without ceasing. Pray. This is funny. I just stated that it's hard to pray for someone else. But I didn't make that up. That's in your Bible. Matthew chapter 26, Jesus is speaking here. He and his disciples are in the Garden of Gethsemane. Jesus' hour has now come. The Romans and the Jews are out to get him. They are ready to crucify him. He and his disciples are in the Garden of Gethsemane. He leaves nine of them behind. He takes Peter, James, and John a little further with him. But then he tells them, y'all stay right here. I'm going to go a little farther and I'm going to pray. Y'all watch. I'm going to go a little further and pray. But then Jesus stays gone for an hour and he returns and he finds his disciples sleeping. Jesus says to his disciples, could you not have prayed with me and for me for just an hour? They were sleeping. Jesus goes back and he prays again and he returns again. And the Bible says that they were sleeping again. He leaves one more time, prays for another hour, and he comes back. And the Bible says that their eyes were heavy, which means that they again were sleeping. Because they found it difficult to pray for his problem, because according to them, his problem wasn't their problem. But when you understand that all of us are in this thing together, you need to be praying for me, I need to be praying for you. Ministers need the prayers of believers. Verses 31 and 32, Paul reveals what he needs believers to ask God for. I got it, Paul, you want us to pray for you. But what should we be praying for? Paul says, I need for you to pray that I be rescued from those who are disobedient in Judea. I need for you to pray that I be rescued from those who are in Judea. What rescue here does indeed mean to be delivered. But it's deeper than that. It doesn't just mean to be delivered from something. It means to be preserved in something. Notice the difference. Paul is not asking the Romans believers, the believers in Rome, to pray that God would keep him from trouble. Paul is asking the Roman believers to pray that God would keep him in trouble. Opened up this morning, I wasn't just talking for my health by quoting Psalm 23. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside the quiet waters. He restores my soul. Yea, though I walk through the valley of death, I will fear no evil. Why? Because God is with me. Paul says, I need for you to pray that God be on my side when I go through what I got to go through. Hear me. But Paul says, I'm a minister of the gospel, and I got to do what God has called me to do, which means that I'm going to have to go through some things. And when I'm going through what I'm going through, I need the saints to be saying, praying for the preacher. Paul says, listen, a preacher's trouble is preacher has to deal with unbelievers, and he got to deal with the headache of believers. I said that jokingly. He has to deal with the threats of non-believers, and then he has to come to the church and deal with the acceptance of believers. Do you see that in your Bible? Paul says, I need you to pray that God would rescue me from those who are disobedient in Judea. Disobedient is a simple reference to a person who refuses to accept Jesus Christ as their Savior. Paul says, when I get to Jerusalem, those who have not accepted Jesus Christ as their personal Lord and Savior, they don't want me there. And since they don't want me there, they are going to try to make my life miserable. They are going to try to destroy me. They are going to try to kill me. They are going to try to get me out of town. But I need for the saints to pray that God will keep me right there. That's Paul's prayer for non-believers. But do you see what Paul asks is for believers? It is, I need for you to pray also. And that my service for Jerusalem, Judea, is connected to those who are disobedient, those who are disobedient, those who have not accepted Jesus Christ as their personal Lord and Savior. But then he says, I need for you to pray that when I get to Jerusalem, in Jerusalem there were people who had accepted Christ as their personal Lord and Savior. He says, I need for you to pray that when I get to Jerusalem, that my service would be proved acceptable to the saints. Did you see Paul's twofold problem? I have a problem with non-believers, and I have a problem with believers. My problem with non-believers is they want me dead. My problem with believers is I have to convince them that I'm working for God. Ain't that something? But Paul says, I'm going to show up to believers, but I've got to prove to them that I'm on God's side. Paul's service, these are keeping you too long, Paul's service was to preach the gospel. Paul performed miracles, yes he did, but he was not a miracle worker. Paul's service, his anointing, his God-given gift was to preach the gospel Christ, particularly to the Gentiles, but it included, but was certainly not limited to just preaching the gospel to the Gentiles. But his gift, his God-given ability, was to preach the word of God wherever he went. Paul says, but it ain't easy preaching. Hear it. It's not even easy preaching to believers. I didn't make that up, ladies and gentlemen. That's in your Bible. Paul says, I need for you to pray that my service, that my preaching would prove acceptable. Word prove here in the text means to appear. It carries the picture of taking the stage. The picture that Paul paints in the text is the picture that you are looking at right now. Paul says, I need for you to pray that when I take the stage, that when I stand behind the pulpit, that when they put the microphone in my hand, I need for you to pray that what I say is acceptable. Here's why I shout, because I just discovered this as a preacher. Paul says, I pray that when I take the stage, what I say to believers is acceptable. The word acceptable literally means agreed upon. Paul says, I'm not asking you to ask God that they like me. I'm asking you to ask God that they agree with me. No, don't you miss it. Paul said, I'm not asking
that's God that they agree with my ideas or the way I want to do things. No, I'm asking you to ask God that when I stand up and start talking about Jesus Christ, that they may lift their hands and say, go ahead, Reverend. I'm asking you that when I take the stage and I start opening my mouth and talking about Mary's woman, that they say, preach, preach up. I'm asking you that they agree with the gospel that I preach. Paul understood, I don't care if you like me or not, but you got to say amen when I'm telling the truth. I don't care what you think about me, but when the truth flows from the lips of a preacher, there ought to be an amen somewhere. There ought to be a hallelujah somewhere. There ought to be a thank you, Jesus, somewhere. Paul says, I pray that you ask God. Those believers down there in Jerusalem would say amen. Yes. You can go some places to preach and nobody say nothing. Hard place to preach. And Paul says that's when I need the believers to be praying for me. Paul says that my gospel may prove acceptable to the saints. I need for you to pray two things. I need for you to pray that God will preserve me when I'm among those who do not know Christ. Then I need for you to pray that when I get among those who do know Christ, that they will receive the gospel that I preach. That's verses 30. 31, verse 30, Paul acknowledges his need for prayer. Verse 31, Paul tells the believers what he needs them to pray for. But in verse 32, Paul informs believers for the purpose they should pray this. He said, I need for you to pray this, verse 32, so that I may come to you with joy, that I may find refreshing rest in your company. Here Paul says, if you don't pray, when I go amongst them unbelievers in Judea, they'll kill me. Paul says, if you don't pray, then when I go to those believers in Jerusalem, they won't accept me. And if they won't accept me, they won't give me the financial means that I need to get to you. Paul says, if you don't pray, then you'll never see me. Paul says, so that I may come to you with joy. Paul says, when I come to you, I'm not coming to you to work, I'm coming to you to rest. This is interesting because many people, even believers, don't think preachers ought to rest. You say, I'm taking a day off. What you saying? You're taking a day off. You're preaching, you're supposed to preach all the time. No, Paul said, I'm coming to you to sit down, rest, and to be refreshed by you. Here, so rest is physical rest that Paul is speaking about. Paul is saying, I'm going to work hard. I've been working hard in Macedonia. I've been working hard in Achaia. I went to Jerusalem. I had to deal with those non-believers. Then I went to Judea, had to deal with those non-believers. Then I went to Jerusalem, had to deal with those believers. Then I traveled to Rome. I came to you to sit down and rest and be blessed by your company. In other words, I came to you for you to wash my clothes for me. Will you do that for me, please? I came to you for you to pour me a glass of water. Can I get a glass of water, please? I came to you to be refreshed by you, because after I leave you, I'm going to Spain to preach
gospel. And Charles Paul says in verse 32, if you don't pray, I can't do anything. If you don't ask God to help me, I can't do nothing. I used to laugh at old school preachers when they would preach and they'd say, y'all ain't praying with me. I used to think, what do you mean we ain't praying with him? And then I messed up and got behind the pulpit and picked up a microphone and said, y'all ain't praying with me. Paul says, I need for you to pray for me. Why? Because ministers need your prayers. And not only should both you and I pray for ministers who carry the gospel of Christ, this is real brief, because ministers need the prayers of believers, but hear me. Secondly, and I'm through, you and I should pray for ministers who carry the gospel of Christ because ministers continuously pray for you. Did you get it? We should pray for ministers who carry the gospel of Christ because ministers need our prayers. We should also pray for ministers who carry the gospel of Christ because ministers continuously pray for believers. In verses 30, 31, and 32, Paul acknowledges his need for prayer. But in verse 33, notice what Paul does. Paul closes his prayer request with a prayer of his own. Heard Pastor Ralph West say one time, the heart of a pastor. If you ever get to watch that on YouTube or somewhere, the heart of a pastor, Ralph Douglas West says, bless me. And you see the heart of a pastor right here in Paul. Paul says, I need for you to pray for me. That's how he opens his argument. But he closes his argument with the heart of a pastor. He closes his argument with a prayer of his own. Verse 33, Paul says, now the God of peace be with you all. Amen. Watch Paul. Now, I didn't ask you to pray for me. I didn't told you what to pray for. I didn't told you why I needed your prayers. But now is my time to pray for you. I need for you to pray for me. And I hope that's what you're doing. I hope that you're praying for me. But that's all I'm going to say about that. Now, may the God of peace be with you. Notice Paul's prayer. God of peace. Peace is indirectly communicated with prosperity. Literally, Paul is saying, may the God of prosperity, may the God of riches, may the God that makes things happen be with you. Why are you praying this, Paul? Paul says in verses 30 through 32, Paul says, I need for you to pray for me, but in order for God to do something when he hears your prayers, I need for you to be on one accord. No, didn't get it. Peace is associated with prosperity. Where there is no peace, there is no prosperity. Where everybody is not working together on one accord, nothing can get accomplished. Paul says, I need for you to pray for me, but I'm praying for you that God will keep you together. Because if you are not together, then God doesn't hear your prayer, and I still won't be helped. Paul says, I'm praying for you that the God of peace will be with you. That you would touch and agree on the same thing. Because God is not a God who dwells in confusion.
We say it all the time. We quote it. Matthew, let me give you the text for it. Matthew chapter 18, somewhere around verses 19 and 20. There, the Bible says, where two or three are gathered together.